Ever get up in the morning and turn on your TV and you see this picture? There'll be a big table. On one end of the table will be a big pile of guns, drugs and money. Standing behind the table, there'll be a bunch of people looking very stern and staring into the camera. They'll look into the camera and they'll make this stupid statement. This will put a big dent in the drug problem as we know it in our community today. You've seen that story. Have you seen it more than once?
After a while, you just get to realize that this is a hamster wheel that law enforcement is on that they just can't seem to get off. The revolving doors of justice, putting a drug dealer in jail only to see them replaced by another, it truly is a never-ending treadmill.
The drug enforcement industry is so massive, now has such a deep history in the fabric of society, that there rarely is an opportunity for people engaged in waging this war to stop and reflect about the most fundamental of all questions, and that is, should we be doing this?
The Royal Canadian Mounted Police, in partnership with the U.S. Drug Enforcement Administration, is very proud to co-host this important international gathering.
Drug enforcement officials from 88 countries are gathered to strategize and share intelligence in the international war on drugs.
Sharing information with our global partners is integral and has led to numerous successful conclusions of key international operations. We all have one common goal, is to combat the evil of international drug trades.
Billions of dollars have been spent on this crusade, and there is no victory in sight. The war is waged on many fronts, on city streets, in the fields of Afghanistan, in the jungles of Colombia, and in countries all over the world. Leading the attack is the American Drug Enforcement Administration, or DEA. Among the growing number of voices calling for peace is LEAP, Law Enforcement Against Prohibition. The men and women of LEAP have served in the front lines in this battle, and they have seen the damage done. Although they are risking their reputations, and in some cases their careers, they feel compelled to speak out as conscientious objectors to the war on drugs.
The idea for LEAP is based on a group called Vietnam Veterans Against the War. And why it's based on them is this. That was one group of people who spoke out against the Vietnam War, who, whether you agreed with them or not on their conclusion, you could not dismiss them for not knowing what they were talking about. We all have different attitudes within LEAP about how the regulated and controlled marketplace should be. What we come together at in LEAP is on the fact that prohibition has to end.
Became a police officer in 1989. My beat is all along the Niagara River, which also forms the international border between Canada and the United States. Currently, I'm assigned to uniform patrol. I respond to all sorts of offenses, occurrences. Being a tourist town, it has its own unique problems. I grew up in a family of four. My father was a career police officer. He went from being a constable all the way up to being chief of police. Even as a young man, I knew that there was something strange about the way we approached narcotics. I had a very close family member be arrested. I was very young at the time, and I had asked my mother, you know, what is this all about? And she explained to me that that person had been arrested for importing the resin of a plant. And that didn't seem to make a lot of sense to me, and it still doesn't make any sense to me. throughout my career, I've seen nothing that would lead me to believe that our current approaches to narcotics work. In fact, they're making things worse. I think there's a great number of officers who do feel as I do, for a combination of reasons they don't wish to speak out. I have no aspirations on promotion or advancement. The views I express are my own, and they don't reflect those of my employer. Drug calls do take a lower priority in my personal level of response. There have been times where I've had to choose between certain calls and drug calls, and I've said I'm not going to that drug call. All of our laws are written in a very permissive way. They don't say an officer shall, they say an officer may arrest for certain offenses or another. Discretion is one of the hallmarks of policing in the West.
A guy flagged me down just over here once and came up to the car and he said, "I've just done too much cocaine and I think I'm gonna overdose. Can you help me?" So I drove him to the hospital right away. He was very panicked. He wasn't a well guy. I was just glad to get him some medical attention.
A lot of people will say that by arresting somebody, well, that's now their gateway to getting help for their addiction. But putting them in jail, ruining their prospects for future employment, seems like a pretty strange way to me to help somebody.
I'm the former police chief for the city of Seattle. I served in that capacity for 6 years. Before that, I served for 28 years in the San Diego Police Department. I do trace my own observations about the drug war to an arrest that I made when I'd been a cop for about 2 years. And I had a 19-year-old in the backseat of my police car, handcuffed. I had arrested him for being in possession of marijuana. This was in his own home, I should say his parents' home. I kicked down the door, which I was legally justified in doing in those days, and I arrested him for the mere possession of a small quantity of marijuana, most of which he had tried to flush down the toilet. And on the way to jail, he's sitting in the backseat of my caged police car saying things like, "Oh, wow." I mean, he's stoned. He's talking about the cage, and he is asking me if I got any Fritos or any Cheetos. I mean, it was that experience. And I think, what the hell am I doing? I could be doing police work. It's inconceivable that we will have a drug-free America. Everywhere in the world, there is evidence of people ingesting various substances that produce mind or mood altering effects. That's always been, that is today, and that always will be. It's not going away.
The criminalization of certain drugs began early in the 20th century. Laws were passed first to ban opium and then later cocaine and marijuana. In the second half of the century, amphetamines and psychedelics were added to the list.
U.S. customs officers and police are having another drive to round up dope smugglers. And here's some of the swag. Concealed in barrels of olive oil, they find millions of dollars worth of deadly heroin. Enough, they say, to kill 6 million people.
Drug enforcement efforts intensified as the century progressed. The U.S. began sending agents to source countries, and the war on drugs became an international concern. United Nations treaties were put in place to ensure that countries could not legalize the banned drugs on their own. In spite of intense global enforcement efforts, drug traffic has never abated.
Traffic in illicit drugs is so serious, its control becomes a policy of the Nixon administration. He creates the Office of Drug Abuse Law Enforcement as the center of a comprehensive drive to eradicate heroin traffic in America. Drug arrests are doubled. Three times as much heroin is seized.
This is one area where we cannot have budget cuts because we must wage what I have called total war against public enemy number one in the United States, the problem of dangerous drugs.
I'm a retired federal officer. In my 32 years, better than 20 of it was spent working in narcotics. We were going into Panama, Colombia, Venezuela, and other Central American countries. I enjoyed working down there because it was exciting. I mean, no other way to put it. It's cowboys and Indians and stuff, and they paid you real money and gave you a badge and a gun. Doesn't get much better than that. When I was a young officer, I guess all of us thought that drugs were bad because that's what we had been taught and told. I mean, some of us had seen Reefer Madness, that classic film. And of course, when we were in the military, we were shown all sorts of terrible things that what drugs would do and wouldn't do. Narcotics arrests were always better than illegal alien or other felony arrests that you can make because the thing was narcotics in those days. I was recruited to go down and work in the Florida Keys, driving a $100,000 boat in the middle of the night, chasing a load of, at that time it was mostly marijuana. Then I went over and joined the Air Marine Division. But this time cocaine was really big. It was just coming out of there and 727 DC-3 just plane loads of narcotics were flying out of Colombia into Mexico. We started working more and more in South America, going to the source country stuff. I've been to Colombia. I've flown over the jungles of Colombia. I know how impenetrable that forest is out there, and the only way in is by boat or airplane. For those that aren't aware, you can take the entire state of Texas and place it inside the country of Colombia. That's huge. Next door is Brazil. You can take the entire United States and put it in the country of Brazil. Think about it. You're looking to spray a cocaine field in Texas. Find it. Spray it. Because there's another 5 million acres out there that you didn't see that day. Yes? You are reporting progress in your spraying programs in Colombia, and you have made progress in the areas that you're spraying in. But I would also point out that when you're spraying in one area, they're cultivating new fields and are producing higher quality crops in other fields. They've got some good farmers down there that are making good progress. I helped fight this war for many, many years, and I saw on a daily basis that we were losing ground. Drugs are cheap. They're easily available. Each year we would seize or assist in seizing megaton loads of cocaine, and it was making absolutely no difference. We have a problem with drugs in this country, and we choose to criminalize the behavior, and then we choose to hold other nations responsible for shipping drugs to our country. Well, it's supply and demand. It's been that way since time began. If you have a demand, someone will find a way to supply it.
People, for whatever reason, choose to consume narcotics. That's really a question best left to professionals, psychologists, psychiatrists. It's something not best left to police officers. We're dealing with economics here, a marketplace, consumers, producers. Prohibition doesn't work because you're dealing with consumer goods which are wanted by a large segment of society. It's exactly similar to the prohibition of alcohol, which both Canada and the United States experimented with in the 1920s and the 30s.
Prohibition became law, and contraband liquor, diluted by a nation's tears, flowed down the drain.
Soon, Chicago, heart of the bootleg industry, had over 10,000 speakeasies. Protecting 125 million Americans from the evils of liquor were 1,500 ill-paid prohibition agents, constantly tempted by graft. Light bulbs almost obliterate the figure of Al Capone, who had himself obliterated so many others.
When you talk about prohibition, the images that spring into people's minds are of old Model T Fords with gangsters smoking cigars with a machine gun, rat-a-tat-tat-tat-tat. The second thing that they always think about, too, is that, well, it never worked.
We didn't legalize alcohol because some new study came out that said alcohol is really okay, you should give it to your babies as soon as they're born, it's wonderful stuff. We legalized alcohol because it only took us 13 years to learn the lesson. And the lesson was alcohol did not create Al Capone. Prohibition of alcohol created Al Capone and the gangsters that roamed our streets. And that legalization of alcohol, we knew, was not going to do anything to solve our alcohol problem. But legalization of alcohol put a huge dent in our crime and violence problem as we knew it. We ended Prohibition in 33. By 1937, the homicide rate was back down to what it was before Prohibition started. And one other thing, everybody didn't become a drunk in 1934.
Howard Wooldridge took his oath to serve and protect very seriously. Now retired from law enforcement, he works on behalf of LEAP to speak out about this failed public policy. Wooldridge rode across America on horseback from Los Angeles to Manhattan on a mission to spread the word.
So this is America where the image of the cowboy, the loner, the going across America, it really tugs at the heartstrings of our nation's history. I want to educate Americans as to the full range of the unintended consequences of this policy of drug prohibition, and that we need to start discussing this issue to reduce crime, reduce death and disease, reduce the cost to the taxpayers, and actually start helping people as opposed to hurting them. We speak mostly to the unconverted, meaning to people in Lions, Kiwanis, groups like that, Rotaries, church groups. We testify before state legislatures, essentially to give a law enforcement perspective that is unconventional in the sense we talk about the problems of prohibition, trying to give them something to think about, absolutely.
Very good. Well, good luck to you.
Thanks.
Howard Wooldridge, our guest this morning.
I have a whole range of experiences from the road. I've had a couple people be upset with me. I've had a couple people threaten to kill me, you know, shoot me right out of the saddle. They're going to go home, get their gun, and just shoot me as they drive by. But that's extremely rare. I know I stopped once and talked to one woman who said she just was so impressed with what I was doing and said, God bless you and keep up the great work. And 30 seconds later, I was a little bit further down the hallway and somebody stopped me and they were ready to take my head off. So it goes up and down all the time. Makes for an interesting day, kind of like police work.
Drugs are readily available to America's youth. Unquote. Drugs are easy to buy. You
know, a lot of people want to understand, why haven't we eliminated the problem? They need to understand that drug dealers accept as a condition of employment death and long prison terms. They know going into it, that's a real possibility anywhere in the world. And we know that there's always someone out there that is stupid enough or greedy enough or desperate enough to become a drug dealer, whether at the bottom or the top. And we arrest thousands and thousands. There's always that someone who will take their place just like that.
Governments, both federal and provincial, are floundering around talking about firearm bans and this and that. Nobody wants to talk about what the root problem is, and it's prohibition. Those gangs are fighting it out over turf and distribution rights. If we legalize drugs tomorrow, we would still have a problem with addictions. Drugs are dangerous, and there would still be problems associated with them. But what would go away are these marketplace problems, the shootings, the beatings, the poisonings.
Basically, drug addiction's insanity. I mean, craziest insanity in the world.
Stand here, you love to stand.
So where do you get the money from for your drugs?
Where do I get the money?
Yeah. Do you do rip-offs, or what do you do?
Oh, but of course.
Buy what?
That's like...
I mean, everybody does.
Distributing non-addictive products.
You've got to do non-addictive products. You're redistributing the wealth.
Very important.
Yeah, that's been known, and there's all kinds of ways.
Probably 90% of all of the property crimes are committed by drug addicts in order to fund their addictions. Property crime, I'm quite sure, would almost disappear if there was some mechanism by which they didn't have to steal to support their habit. I was a member of the Vancouver police for 28 years.
I haven't been down here for 10 years. I understand that that today there is much more leeway given, which I absolutely agree with, because if we take the drugs off that person, they've got it through prostitution, through drug dealing, through stealing. All they're going to do if we take their drugs off them is they're going to have to go and rob somebody else or break into another car or deal somewhere else. So we haven't really achieved anything. We're really going to create another crime.
Okay, this girl turns around. There used to be a set rule, you know, that sisters back sisters and help. She goes and backs a sister and somebody steals her wallet. You know,
Well, there's too many junkies around.
Yeah, the whole anti-drug user addict junkie, you know?
Well, there are. But if the first hurdle is to get the money, then they have to buy a product or find a dealer who's an honest dealer and isn't going to sell them rubbish or isn't going to sell them, or if it's too strong, they're going to overdose and, you know, they're going to end up in the morgue. So they go through this every day. They're people. And the biggie which really concerns me is the guys up top, the big suppliers, are making a fortune out of this.
It was the involvement of the gangs in drugs, and in fact, it seemed to us that we were just handing the gangs millions and millions of dollars. We can give the drug industry to three groups of people. We can give it to private enterprise, we can give it to the government, or we can give it to the criminals. And we've made the worst choice. We've given it to the criminals.
Always take even appreciable criminal justice risks for selling small amounts of drugs for large amounts of money. We have a zero tolerance here, a more radical approach, really, than any other westernized democracy. And we have a bigger drug problem than any other Western industrialized country as well. I'm convinced there's a connection. My name is Judge Jim Gray. I'm a judge of the Superior Court in Orange County, California, and I've been a trial judge now for more than 21 years. Before that, I was a federal prosecutor in the United States Attorney's Office in Los Angeles, and before that, a Navy JAG attorney, criminal defense attorney in the Navy. I'm a former drug warrior. I held the record for the largest drug prosecution in the Central District of California in Los Angeles. Back then in 1978, it was 75 kilos of heroin, 160 pounds. That was and is a lot of heroin. You have any concept of what the record drug prosecution is today in the Central District of California? 18 tons of cocaine in one transaction. So you can tell what all of this rigorous prosecution has done. I'm a conservative judge in a conservative county. I have never used any form of illicit drugs. I am not a public defender wearing a beard from Berkeley. So people have to listen to my message. The costs on the court system as to drug prohibition are unbelievable. About 80% of all felony crime we have in Los Angeles and Orange County are drug-related crime. Possession with intent to sell, conspiracies to sell, the violence involved with your trying to protect your fiefdom against my coming in on it. the burglaries, the prostitution, things that people do to get the money to pay for these drugs. Then we have sentencing for drug paraphernalia. That is to say, if you are a heroin addict, it is illegal for you to possess a hypodermic needle and syringe. It's easier for these people to get the drug themselves than it is the clean needle. What you need to do with regard to the criminal justice system is to hold people accountable for what they do, hold them accountable for their actions, instead of what they put into their bodies. If you or I drive a motor vehicle impaired by any of these drugs, methamphetamine, cocaine, alcohol, whatever, that's a crime. Criminal justice system should be involved. Why? Because now their actions are putting our safety at risk, and that's the difference. But in my view, the law has no more ability or appropriateness to decide what you or anyone else puts into their bodies. If anything, that's a medical issue, and eventually we will come to our senses and get out of this entire medical area.
I remained in the downtown east side for many years. A lot of police officers who are down there don't last 1 or 2 years even. The drug issue permeated the whole atmosphere down there. It's more important to them than food, than sex, than sleep, than anything in their life. And I had never really known people like that before, or addiction issues to that extent, so. Well, this is probably 6 months on the job, coming out of the police academy. As a beat officer, you can make drug arrests hand over fist. At one time, me and my partner, Al Arsenault, were making anywhere from 8 to 11 arrests a night. And did we make a difference? Did we win the drug war? We didn't do anything there. I did not demonize them or anything. I just saw them as vulnerable people lost in a place that's going to eat them up, and tried to help them out. This shot here, it's actually a harm reduction effort. Some of the locals had typed out this notice and taped it up. Very strong heroin is now available. Many people have died from overdosing on this. Try small amounts until you know the strength of the heroin in question. Be safe. This is one of the heroin users who didn't make it. They're trying to bring her back to life, but they don't make it. She was about 18, I think. This is a shot standing above an alcove in an alley. This woman is upside down, and that guy actually has a needle he's going to inject into her neck. Their drugs were for personal use, and we didn't make those kind of arrests. We just couldn't be bothered. We only made arrests for those who were dealing and trafficking in drugs, and that kept us busy. We couldn't arrest enough of those. You know what? It's almost punishment enough what they're doing to themselves in that kind of filthy condition, that there's nothing that we could do to dissuade them. Through putting them through the criminal justice system.
Still smiling.
Always. Did you get that sliver out of your hand? God, you keep walking with that syringe, you're gonna jam it right through it.
From my point of view, the user on the street is simply suffering from a medical illness. He's addicted. The police are involved because it's a law and they enforce the law. In the 70s, you know, if you pop somebody for, say, a pound of heroin, 2 pounds of heroin, I mean, this place would go crazy. You know, it would dry right up. I mean, they've taken 40, 50 keys of it off. Don't even miss a beat. In fact, in the 90s, they took off 30 keys and the death toll went up. I don't know why, but I mean, that's just that. In the old days, it'd just be, this place would be scratching. You could drive down to Oppenheimer Park and there'd be addicts just in terrible withdrawal. But there's so much of it, there's a glut of it. That's why, you know, it's cheap, easy to get a hold of. Contrary to all of the, you know, the UN stats and that, I mean, you know, the fact of the matter is Afghanistan is growing leaps and bounds. And, you know, we don't see any, I've never seen any drop here.
Larry Campbell was a steelworker from Brantford, Ontario. At 21, he joined the Royal Canadian Mounted Police. The Mounties assigned him to British Columbia, where he worked on the drug squad in the Vancouver area for 8 years. After 12 years of policing, Campbell became a coroner and then chief coroner for British Columbia.
Becoming a coroner, it wasn't the law that I was concerned about. It was that people were dying, and why were they dying, and what can we do about it? And that was sort of that's the change I had in philosophy, which, you know, was a struggle for a while to figure out exactly, you know, I guess, who was I or who am I?
Larry Campbell ran for mayor of the city of Vancouver on a harm reduction platform. He won, and InSight, the first legal supervised safe injection site in North America, was opened.
Excuse me, I'm talking to the ex-mayor of Vancouver.
Hi, how are you?
Good to see you.
What are you up to? You behaving yourself?
Huh? Oh, you know, look at. I tried.
Oh, Jesus. Did you go have it looked at?
No.
You're abscessing.
I know, that's true.
Are you at InSight?
I was at InSight, yeah. I've been there. I got a.
Well, go into InSight. Yeah. Do you want to have nothing left of the arm? Because that's too big. Here, tell him I sent you, okay, that I saw you on the street and you guys need help. Okay, I don't want to find this on a washroom wall down here, okay? For an average time phone Larry Campbell, I don't want that, okay? We'll see you later. Take care.
Larry Campbell's life was the inspiration for the hit TV series Da Vinci's Inquest. In 2005, he was appointed to the Senate of Canada.
Let's legalize marijuana. Let's just legalize it, okay? It's $7 billion in British Columbia. You know, let's legalize it. Let's tax the hell out of it. And let's take all that money and put it into health care, straight in. Not into general revenue, straight into health care. Let's make cocaine and heroin available for prescription use on a doctor's orders. We can work our way out of this. I mean, we can help the people who are addicted. We can prevent people from getting into it by telling them the truth. We can supply on-demand treatment, and we can supply harm reduction until they're, just to keep them alive, until they're ready to go into that.
We came pre-mixed. Normally, I would give you the flat, pouring it in, but I had to buy it like this. Okay.
You know, you could put a bucket of heroin and a bucket of cocaine on every street corner, and still only a certain amount of the population would touch it. Why make it a criminal act? Put people in jail. You're creating work. That's what I think.
We imply that every crack user's an addict, every heroin user's an addict. Now, we know economically that's absurd. Because we know that if you're a multi-billion dollar heroin industry, you ain't making multi-billion dollars by selling to addicts. There just isn't enough of them and enough money. You need a huge amount of non-addicted users of these drugs in order to keep your business going.
If you want to look at the statistics before the Harrison Drug Act of 1914, we had 1.3 or 1.4% of the population addicted to drugs. And the consensus was, we can't have that. This is bad. We can't do. We got to do something about that. That's too many people. Well, today, 1.3 to 1.4% of the people are addicted to drugs. So we haven't changed the addiction rate over all these years.
And that's that.
Now, I concede that the population has increased, so the numbers have increased. But percentage-wise, it's the same as it was before we passed all these laws against it.
There is collateral damage for those we ask to fight this war.
There's no question in my mind
that enforcing drug laws has created incredible levels of tension between the community and the police. It has damaged the reputation of the law enforcement agency. It's damaged the relationship. Narcotics enforcement puts cops in an untenable situation. They're enforcing laws that, in many cases, they don't believe in.
When I joined the police force in the 1970s, they didn't even ask you what drugs you had used. They expected essentially every police candidate to have smoked marijuana, for example, and possibly done other drugs. It was not even brought up during the interviews. I stopped before I went to the police academy. Police departments know if they stopped hiring people because of past illegal drug use, you would have essentially nobody signing up to be a police officer. But we don't make the laws, we enforce them.
There is a growing resentment towards law enforcement, especially in regards to cannabis. When you do have large numbers of the community that are consumers of cannabis, they have a secret. We're supposed to be friendly protectors, not the people that you keep secrets from, unless you have something to hide. And simple possession and use of cannabis isn't, in my opinion, something that should be hidden. Our drug laws have affected the public's view of the police, and in a negative fashion.
As with all wars, number one, you have to have an enemy. That enemy turns out to be our fellow citizens.
If the drug war is a good thing, everybody believed in it, the word narc wouldn't be a bad word. I spent about 15 years in law enforcement, 3 years working in uniform, and about 12 years undercover for various agencies. When you see drug guys on TV, there are usually a couple of them. They go out and they take an informant or something out and they go do a buy. They have some surveillance guys. We actually went out and spent 6 months to a year in infiltrated towns. And so you're into the undercover, you know, 24 hours a day, 7 days a week. It's the psychology of war. And if once you make the enemy evil enough, it's okay to use any means to destroy that enemy. The drug dealer that the media portrays is some guy standing on a street corner selling little kids. In truth, the drug dealer is one of your friends or neighbors who knows five or six other people that smoke pot or whatever, and they gather some money together and give to him, and he knows a friend who can get some. And that is the reality of a drug dealer. Undercover is just dirty, nasty business. I mean, you get to know people, their kids, their family, and then you have to go back and destroy that family. It's a tough thing to do. We'd made a pot buy from a fellow, and we were going in to serve a search warrant and do an arrest. And I was third or fourth in through the door, and as you go in, you clear the first room and go into other rooms. And this fellow he didn't appear to have a weapon. The officers bypassed him and went into other rooms. And I put a gun to his head and put him to the ground, and as I looked up, his 8-year-old daughter was standing in the doorway of the kitchen, and the look on her face was just real tough. And it didn't bother me much until my daughter got to be that age, and then it started to bother me. I don't think the drug war is right anymore. Dad's in prison for 10 years or something. The kids don't have a father. I know families that have just been destroyed.
There are enormous racist implications associated with drug prohibition.
There are conspiracy theorists, for lack of a better term, who believe that when Nixon declared war on drugs, he was purposely declaring war on the black community. Whether that was his intent or not, that has been the effect. Drug offenses are certainly not confined to the black community, and in fact, there's every reason to believe that drug use is higher among whites than it is among blacks. We like to gnash our teeth over the breakup of the African-American family. That's been a sort of a recurring theme among politicians and social scientists for decades. And yet we don't stop to think that we're putting those people in jail on the order of 7 to 8 times higher than we'll find among the white community for nonviolent drug offenses.
Another unintended consequence of drug prohibition is corruption within the ranks of law enforcement.
We want our police officers to be pure and respectable, and I think most of them are, but prohibition dangles some pretty large carrots in front of them, and naturally there will be some who are suckers for the bait.
Every major instance of police corruption in the last several decades throughout the world are traceable to drugs. The exception would, in fact, prove the rule.
In the 1960s, New York City's police department was notoriously corrupt. Consensual crimes such as prostitution, drugs, and numbers rackets provided plenty of opportunity for cops to get in on the action. For refusing to be corrupted, Detective Frank Serpico found himself facing the blue wall of silence. Some of his fellow officers may have wished him dead, but he has kept his dignity and sense of justice. Hollywood's version of his life starred Al Pacino. It was based on a novel called Serpico, the classic story of the cop who couldn't be bought.
Every time they questioned me, they tried to prove that what I was saying was untrue, rather than take the attitude that allow me to assist them in an investigation. I hope that police officers in the future will not experience the same frustration and anxiety that I was subjected to for the past 5 years at the hands of my superiors because of my attempt to report corruption.
People say, my name is known all over the world.
For Detective Serpico.
And for what? What did I do? I did my job the way it was meant to be done. I'm Frank Serpico. I'm a former New York City police detective. I was shot in the line of duty. I was left on the ground to bleed to death. My so-called partners did not call for a backup. You know, I had guys say to me, you know, Frank, the day you testified before the Knapp Commission was a dark day for every policeman in New York City. And I said, he says, I was afraid to go home and face my wife and children. I said, really? Why? What did you do wrong? He said, nothing. I said, why didn't you come and support me? And he said, what, and be an outcast like you? The sad thing is, there's a fraternity, and guys join the fraternity and forget the oath that they took was not to the police department, but the people that they serve. And when you see a cop, you should feel protected. You shouldn't feel threatened. I think prohibition is causing the public to lose their respect because they're enforcing laws that basically aren't hurting anybody. I think we have to stop the hypocrisy. If you're a CEO on Park Avenue, you can dial a phone and the next thing some guy will be in front of you in a three-piece suit and an attaché case and he'll open it up and you have your drug of choice. But the guy in the street who wants to take the edge off, you don't have to go there and get the little guy. If you want to make an arrest, go after the guys that are making the profit. And they might be surprised where that road takes them. I think part of the drug war is the prison industry. They run it like real estate. You know, they have so many rooms and they have to rent them out. And they rent them out and the police fill them.
We're putting 1.5 million people in jail a year for consensual nonviolent crimes. And it's not going down. We're not putting less people in jail this year than we did last year. We're putting more people in jail. So then if we're putting more people in jail, we should be making progress. No, we're not. We should be putting less people in jail if we're winning, because then we would put all the bad guys in jail and one being left, and now we should be losing, but we're not. Because when you put a drug dealer in jail, you don't take someone out of the matrix, you create a job opening.
In the States, they have more people in jail than any other country in the world. We're asked to take our moral compass from people who dealt with Noriega, who had the Contra scandal where they were trading drugs for guns. I mean, you know, come on. It's more part of their foreign policy than it is part of law enforcement.
My whole adult life, I've always wanted to be in law enforcement because I'm trying to follow my father's footsteps. Finally, in 1979, I was hired as one of the very few Latinos in DEA. It was in Vietnam where I first saw a lot of my fellow soldiers lay low from shooting up heroin and dying on an overdose of heroin and so forth. And I promised myself that if I did survive that war, that I would initiate my own drug war by becoming a federal drug agent, which I did. I was doing a lot of undercover operations of drug trafficking from South to Central America to the U.S. We were on jungle operations and search and destroy missions on the cocaine labs, and I came across the Colombian drug traffickers playing soccer with the military. And I couldn't understand why they were sworn enemies, why they were together. And that's when I realized that we were still supporting cocaine democracies, and those are democracies that the United States government allowed them to sleep with the cartels in the name of democracy. Iran-Contra was the sales of missiles to Iran. Lieutenant Colonel Oliver North sold missiles to Iran, which was a very illegal act. And turned around and used those funds allegedly to help the Contras in Nicaragua, which was the opposing party to the Sandinistas, and of course the U.S. government was supporting the Contras. My role, I had people working for me at the Ilopango Airport in El Salvador. Oliver North worked at Ilopango Airport. That's when my camera went into full speed. I started taking pictures of everything. I had gathered intelligence that the Contras were heavily involved in drug trafficking. We transported the drugs from Central and South America to the U.S., and in return flights, they brought weapons for the Contras. I gathered intelligence on it, reported to Washington, and basically most of my reports went into what was known as the black hole. And of course, at the end of the day, we realized that the Contras were heavily involved in drug trafficking with the CIA, and certainly very much involved in atrocities of killing of a lot of innocent people in Nicaragua. They took my dream away. I strongly believe that I put my life on the line, that I would make a difference. And obviously, that was not what it was all about, and I realized that we were the bad guys. America is more addicted to drug money than they are to drugs.
It's all about the money. We want the war to go on and on and on because it's to someone's benefit.
The United Nations Office of Drugs and Crime estimates that the retail global illicit drug market is valued at $322 billion. That's higher than the gross domestic product of 88% of the countries in the world. Intelligence, intelligence, intelligence. It is all about that. If we are really to have the kind of impact that we're here to deliver to the world's greatest evil organizations.
It's not a war, it's a business. Let's imagine if we took out all of the drugs in the world, okay? Just imagine that. Police, courts, social services, healthcare. It just goes on and on. It touches every segment of our society. All lawyers, judges. I mean, what would we do with all of these people? Gee, we might actually get community policing. We might actually start taking a look at how we deal with healthcare problems.
Any drug is essentially readily available to young people. If by regulating the drug, we could control its distribution, control its costs, control its quality, shift resources from enforcement of drug possession, or drug sales for that matter, to the prevention, the enlightenment, the education of our citizenry, and a treatment to those who need the treatment. That's just a much smarter way to go.
People generally think that if drugs were legalized, that there would be drugs everywhere. Of course, there already is drugs everywhere.
My son got stopped. They found a roach in the ashtray. He was arrested. It's come home to me. The drug war has now hit me. My son just graduated from a pharmacy technician. If he's convicted, he could never work as a pharmacist or as a technician. Never been in trouble before, ever. And in 1 month, his life has been destroyed. I mean, is this what the war on drugs is all about?